Hello, everybody, and welcome to The Seventh Rule with Cirroc Lofton.
Hello, hello.
My name is Ryan T. Husk. Look at who has joined us. It is Denise Crosby. Part of the family. Also part of the family, of course. So good to have you back. Malissa Longo is here as well.
Hi.
Now, today we're doing a very special episode. We're doing a mailbag episode. Our patrons and donors sent in a bunch of questions. We are going to answer a bunch of them. We're going to have a lot of fun. And hey, if you think of more questions, add them in the comments below and we'll get to them retroactively somehow. Through the make sure you like this video. Make sure you are subscribed to this channel. If you're listening in wherever podcasts are found, please give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. We really appreciate it. And now on with the show. By the way, how are you, Denise? It's been a while.
Oh, I'm so good. It's great to see you guys. Always. I'm back from GalaxyCon in Columbus. And right before that, I did GalactiCon in Denver. So back and strike over. And here we go. Kind of winding down for the year. So no more appearances for me, except nice. Right here on your beautiful Zoom screen.
So we definitely did. The reason for a mailbag episode, everybody, is because we've just finished and closed the book on seasons 1 and 2 of Star Trek The Next Generation. Season 2 was kind of a shortened season, so we wanted to fill it out a little bit more. And before we turn the page and embark on season 3, we want to look back. And so these questions are specifically about seasons 1 and 2 of The Next Generation, because they're kind of like their own microcosm of weirdness before we move forward. Denise knows.
Before some writers actually come on board.
Some good ones.
Right. Yeah. For sure.
All right. Are you guys ready to start with the first question?
Yeah. Let's do this.
All right. Actually, Malissa, would you like to read this first question? We're going to start with an easy one to get us warmed up, like just a super chill one.
Okay.
Here it is.
For the group, what was your favorite Mr. Deja episode and or scene for season 1 or 2? Thank you, Chuck A. Yay.
So I guess I'll start with this to give you guys a little bit of time to think about it. Shoot, I need more time too. Malissa, can you buy us all some time? Can
you buy us some time? Mr. Data was who?
Mr. Data. I really, he has so many great moments in season 1 and 2. Measure of a Man. That's one of my favorite episodes ever, because it's just so wonderfully done, wonderfully written by Melinda Snodgrass. It's really great. And Data has some wonderful moments in that, but I also like him in Elementary, My Dear Data. And because that was fun. Oh, and wasn't he in The Big Goodbye? I like that episode too.
Where
he was from France, wasn't he, or something like that?
No, actually, that's what I was thinking might be my favorite scene or moment for Mr. Data, was when he said, when he goes, and this is Mr. Data, or this is, and he goes, Carlos. South America. And I was actually thinking that's going to be what I'm going to say, because it's just, it gives you the first hint as to why people like Data so much, is because he's just so beautifully clueless in a lot of ways. He says Carlos, and anybody looks at him is like, you don't look like, you don't even look like a human, but let alone a Carlos from South America. You got no accent. He's not from South America, or we'd probably be able to tell. I don't know if the universal translator can change accents or anyway, it's just, it's beautiful. It's clueless. It's innocent. It's fun. You know, it's like this lighthearted innocence that hurts nobody. It's makes people laugh. It's very charming and cute. And that's what I like about him. But Denise, you look like you're going to throw something out.
Well, I was just thinking that, you know, that is so emblematic of who Brent is. You know, he brings that to his role so well, because he is so funny in real life, and he's so witty and sharp that he just is able to, you know, I mean, Data could have been played so differently by someone who didn't have those qualities. So having just seen him last weekend and laughed my butt off with him again, I mean, and I looked at him and I said, I'm your best audience, because he just cracks me up, as he did constantly on the show. So, which leads me to the moment that I love so much with him, of course, is in The Naked Now, when I ask him, you know, if he's fully functional, and you know, it's still ridiculous. I mean, his face was just said everything. I begged him not to look at me while he's acting, because I couldn't keep it together. It was just so funny and so silly and interesting at the same time. So that would be my personal favorite with him.
Yay.
Yeah, I have so many favorites too. I think that one, Denise, is one of my favorite as well. Just, you know, Brent is so amazing at playing this character. He does it in a way that it seems very innocent. It's comical. It's intelligent but naive at the same time. So it's amazing. It's such an amazing note that he hits with his performances. You know, I used to watch Cheers a lot, and I would love the way Woody Harrelson played that character. And it was, you know, sometimes it was witty, sometimes it was just so dumb, but it was just ways that he hits these notes. And Brent is so amazing at hitting these kinds of comical notes that are also meant not to be comical, but also told in a robotic way. So it's like he's just so many different things that are going on when he's giving these performances. So one of them for the second season that I thought of was when Pulaski is saying something to the effect of data, what's the difference? And he says, well, you know, one is my name, the other is not. And perfect. Just the way he delivers that line, I thought it was fantastic. And also, when the question was asked, I was thinking it was Chuck was talking about, are they asking the moments when Picard is frustrated with Data and he's like, Mr. Data, you know, I thought that was how the question was, you know, I interpreted the question when I first heard it. So I was thinking, where were the moments when Picard really was just like, all right, that's enough, Data, you know? And I thought of the episode Schizoid Man, where Data's giving a eulogy to the doctor that was in that episode, and in that eulogy he was going on and Picard, you know, is obviously, you know, done with this eulogy, and he says, I'm almost finished, sir. He tells Picard, and Picard says, no, you are finished.
You are
wonderful back and forth between the two of them. I love the way Picard shows frustration when he feels like Data just running on too long and just giving way too much backstory. We don't need all this information right now. That's enough. And so, you know, that's another kind of comical play, interplay between the characters that have really come to enjoy watching these first two seasons.
You know, I love that you made the comparison of him to Woody in Cheers. Yeah. I never made that connection, but it completely works. Like, as soon as you said that, I thought of two Woody quotes that fit perfectly with Data's personality. One is when someone says something to the effect of whatever that line is about, you can catch more flies with honey than with vinegar or something like that. Mm-hmm. And he goes, maybe I shouldn't be butting in, but you could catch the most with dead raccoons or something like, you know, it's just, that's a Data line. You know, he said, actually, yeah, you could catch the most. Yeah. Or when there's that French guy, Henri, that is, you know, like my idol, basically. And he's always like, Woody, I'm going to steal your girlfriend. And then Woody very innocently says, you know, Henri, I don't know how things are in France, but in America, we don't go around saying we're going to steal other people's girlfriends. It's not polite. He knows. Anyway.
Yeah.
So here is, and I'm never going to be able to not connect those two now.
Yeah.
Here's the next one from our good friend, May Borello. May Borello says to all four of you, is there an episode in either season one or two that you find yourself thinking about from time to time? It might not be a popular episode, but it had a lasting impression on you. Thank you. That's a great question.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Any episode where Riker's getting laid, that just pops up.
Doesn't narrow
which
it down
is a lot
much.
Of episodes. First half the episodes there.
Oh my gosh. Big impression.
What was that? That they were the justice? That yes. Justice episode?
Yeah.
That I sometimes go back to just because it was that, you know, fun to watch everybody kind of indulge in that. In that orgy. Yeah.
All of the oils.
Yeah.
The oily, yeah. Those outfits. I can't, like, once you see them, you cannot not see
it. You can't unsee it.
Especially because I Google it every day, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I have seen people cosplay, not very often, maybe like twice in 36 years in the Justice outfits. And I'm like screaming, you know, it's just not to believe, you know, that they go there. God, that's pretty good. Boy.
I also say that outfit you were rocking in the Naked Now, that just laughs back every once in a while. That silver with the headband and everything looking all ready to go.
Oh, God.
That was a great deal.
The I Dream of Jeannie outfit that could actually show a navel, you know, that, you know, she wasn't able to in her day. And, you know, they came along.
Just
and
a reminder for everybody out there. There's a little sketch.
Amazing.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow, right on cue.
Oh, my goodness. Amazing. I have a picture on my table when I go to these cons of that episode from The Naked Now. And Whitney, who is Brent's assistant, came over to my table this weekend, and she just looked at that photo and said, that is the greatest thing I have ever seen. I was laughing so hard, but that's one that pops into my head every so often.
You know what pops into my head? And it's just kind of a random, it's like the one Angel One with the dude showing a little nipple cleavage. With Riker showing a little nipple cleavage and the tall women. And I don't know if it was because of the guest that we had who was so amazing, or if I just didn't really recall that episode, but that one kind of pops in my head sometimes. The one that had a lasting impression on me throughout ever since I saw it like 30 years ago was Arsenal of Freedom, when they're shooting those AI leggings, eggs, cases. Mm. I think those are the ones that, when I look back at those, kind of stick out. The Antikins and Sele, too, just because of the cool makeup
Yeah, that was
Lonely Among Us, well, I think.
Yeah, I have to mention Conspiracy because heads blowing up and disgusting tube grubs on the table. It's so memorable.
I also remember the moment, it was a LeVar Burton moment when Geordi was given his sight and saying how, you know, he didn't want it. It's, I don't know, emotionally, it connects with me when I think back on that moment.
Well, Emissary kind of does that for me too. It had an impact that I didn't expect to have. So,
you know what I think of often actually is some of the guest cast that were aliens that we didn't get to see again, like Dr. Salar. Like, I keep looking back, like they introduced this character in the second season, a Vulcan doctor played by Susie Plaxen, and it was great. And then you look at all the possibilities. Oh, now our lead doctor character has somebody to play off of in medical episodes, or they can have one on the ship and one on away mission, because you need more than one doctor on a ship. That you might need one on the away mission and one on the ship. Like, it just seemed like it opened the door for more. And then they just had the one episode and never saw her again. Or like the two Benzites we were introduced to, that John Putch played both of them, Mordok and Mendon. I thought that would be cool to have Mendon, Ensign Mendon, as just a character. Or Sonia Gomez, who was introduced in the second season. She was in two episodes in a row. It was clear that they introduced her to have her as a recurring character, because she wasn't really part of the story. They just kind of showed that they crammed her in there just to give her an introduction and then never used her again. It seems she left the show or there was something like that. And it's just a lot of those kinds of situations that I look back at, because there's so much potential. And obviously I look back at Tasha Yar. Just yesterday I was thinking, because my mind always wanders, I think, what would happen if somebody else left the show? Like if Riker left the show, would they replace him with a new character, or would Tasha Yar become the first officer? And I start picturing Tasha Yar as the first officer and how great that would be. We would love it. I'm sure Denise, you might get a few more lines. You would need a cardboard cut out of your legs back there.
Yeah. Well,
I mean, again, you know, it, especially when I go to these cons, you know, and you have fans coming up to you saying, you know, what a missed opportunity, you know, with this character. And, you know, again, that is absolutely, having watched them with you guys, you know, you really clearly see that they didn't fully explore this character enough.
I would have been really interested to see what Michael Piller did with Tasha Yar.
Because
he was wonderful with character development, and he would have taken her to some really interesting places.
I have a kind of a general question, just as the, like, because I don't know, is there a security ops person on the original series?
Chekhov was
security.
Okay. It wasn't very as obviously, you know, placed, or it was just kind of, they needed a security officer. So then they're like, okay, well, let's put Chekhov isn't designated on to anything on the show. So we'll just kind of, you know, make him that. But he wasn't, I don't believe he was ever like introduced initially as our new, you know, chief of security
officer. Like, and was Chekhov wearing the color, a different color relative to the other?
Original series, the colors actually flipped after original series, which is really strange. So everybody in gold in the original series translates to red in the Next Generation. So these guys were in red. So the red shirts were actually security people and engineers and things like that. It's all kind of
okay.
So Tasha would have been in red in the original series.
Okay. I was just trying to see if they had already done a good job at identifying that role and, you know, written well for it in the past. It doesn't seem like it was a clearly defined, well-written kind of role in the past. And clearly when, you know, Denise is doing it, that it doesn't seem like they have a clear idea of what they want that role to be either. And it only becomes clearer later, I think, not even in the second season, I really felt Worf really starting to really fully feel like the security guy, but it's not even developed yet.
I don't even know what the intention was in the first season bringing Worf in, except that you wanted to have a Klingon on the bridge. I think that was really all they had in mind. So it was like, well, what are you doing here? Mm-hmm. And it felt like that so much to me. Throughout
that was a late addition, from what I understand, on the chaos on the bridge.
They said he was the last one, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. that was a Gene Roddenberry kind of rewrite, from my understanding, that he created Q and Worf. On his rewrite of Encounter at Farpoint.
Somebody else. I think Gene was opposed to having Klingons on the bridge. Okay. And it was somebody, but I don't remember who it was that like kind of snuck him on or something like that. But he was the last addition, I believe, is what they were saying. And like, it sounds like they just wanted to have a Klingon on the bridge, you know, be more inclusive, be more sci-fi, be, you know, add extra characters. But I don't think they had a role for him. They're just just kind of be there. We'll figure it out on the fly.
You'll help Tasha, but what is Tasha doing? You know, so it was like a big blob.
Whereas later on in Deep Space Nine, they had a very clear agenda for Rene Auberjonois and his role as security officer. They gave him the backstory that he was part of the Deep Space Nine station prior to the Federation taking over. So they gave him a really good backstory. They gave him an outlined position and role. And he was the main kind of adversary to balance off of Armin and the Ferengi that they were going to have on board the station. So there was already the conflict was built into that, too. So they had a clear vision of, there's going to be conflict between these two characters. He's going to be a tough, you know, strict security officer who's not really that strict, but appears to be.
Can you imagine if they would have done that with Tasha and Worf?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like he comes in and he is also part of the security detail, but she's like, I don't need you. They would go head to head.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, that she, he would be infringing upon that role, that detail. And there would be all that male-female hostility built in. You know, you're not as strong as a Klingon. Oh, yeah? You want to try that? You know? I mean, it would have – there's so many possibilities, you know. Mm-hmm. In hindsight, you know, we can see that. But it wasn't happening.
Well, and it's interesting that Worf and Data were the only non-humans on the bridge. At that time versus Deep Space Nine, where there are mostly aliens and ops, and Captain Sisko and Chief O'Brien were the only humans.
Right.
And
kind of a reverse. So, and then we've got Deanna Troi, but she's only half Trill. She's half human, half Trill. And Picard hardly listens to her anyway. Sorry, what did I say?
Trill.
Definitely not Trill. Cirroc, you are in for a treat when you see the Trill in the Next Generation. Oh. You're going to be like, that's a Trill? We do not discuss it with outsiders. All right. So we've got, half Betazoid. Here's another great question. You want to read this one for us, Malissa Longo? It's kind of along these lines, so it's pretty relevant.
Did you witness any transformation in yourselves while watching these episodes? That is, did any of the episodes have a message that truly resonated with you? Greg Kenzo. I guess that's to the group.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Again, you know, my experience was a little bit different in just going through the season one again for the first time. I've talked about it before on the show that I don't think it would have happened had this opportunity not presented itself. I mean, I seriously don't know if I would have ever seen them again. So that in and of itself is, you know, a gift that I was able to, at a distance, watch with a certain perspective and just appreciate it, you know, reinforce sort of the reason that it exists at all, that it's loved and people watch it. And I had a certain connection with the role of Tasha Yar. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it was really, that was transformative for me.
Mm-hmm. I can say that, like, for me, yeah, I thought that I'd seen all of Next Generation in syndication on reruns as a, you know, back in the day. But turns out, if I had seen these first two seasons, I do not remember about 70% of it. Some episodes I remember little bits, you know, like certain scenes or certain characters. No episodes do I remember, like, had I remembered totally, completely, except for maybe Arsenal of Freedom, because I feel like that one I saw a few times in syndication. That one kept coming up. So that was the one that really stuck in my head. And the one, what's it called? A Matter of Honor, where Riker goes over to Klingon ship and Mendon the Benzite in the second season comes onto the Enterprise. Those were the only two I really had a very clear memory of. The others, I either had no memory or I just had little flashes. Oh, and of course, the first episode, Encounter at Farpoint. I'd seen that one a bunch of times. So that's what was transformative to me, was just getting a much better understanding of what I supposedly called my favorite show. But I'm like, you got to see the whole thing to be able to call it that. Otherwise, you got to see the good and the bad, not just season seven, and call yourself say it's, that's your favorite show. I'm like, oh, season two, episode four. Nah, I don't know. I don't know if I'm ready to see that one yet. I don't know. What about you, Cirroc? Any transformations or anything that resonated with you?
Well, the biggest transformation for me was kind of seeing everybody performing and doing their acting. I feel like I know everybody from, you know, being on the lot and, you know, we're in the family together, but I didn't really know them for the work that they were doing. And watching these actors perform and give them their best and watch the process play out, and also watching them break ground on some kind of new thing, a new idea, expanded farther than it was before, and really you know, laying the foundation for a show like Deep Space Nine to come around. It gives me a different level of respect for the work that they did, for the appreciation that I have for the work they did, which was able to build this legacy, and you know, the successes that they had in Next Generation allowed for all of these various shows that came afterwards, these subsequent shows, and there's been so, you know, so many of them now. And that really lays heavy on the groundwork and the foundational work that everybody on the Next Generation did in these first two seasons and subsequently throughout the show. So that's one thing that transformed for me, is just that I have a newfound respect for people that I already felt a kinship with. But now I feel a respect for the craft, the work that they put in, the performances that they gave. And seeing those performances just, you know, lets me know, okay, they really picked some of the best people they could find out there to bring this vision to life. It's not easy to completely take this world of space and living in the, you know, on the spaceship and make it work and make it believable. But it takes creativity. It takes great actors who have the imagination and are also willing to challenge themselves and giving a morality as a baseline for this imaginative creative space. So that's the transformation for me, is I have a whole new respect for the people that came before me and laid down some amazing foundational work for an entire, you know, genre of storytelling.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're on mute. You're on mute.
Oh, sorry. I was asking you if you felt transformed by anything.
Sorry. Well, I have a similar response to both Ryan and Cirroc in that watching the first two seasons, I most of it I hadn't seen before. And so it was neat diving into this new world and discovering and taking deep dives into kind of a new launching pad for Star Trek as a whole. And seeing that through line through to current Trek, we're still seeing many of these seeds that were laid in these first two seasons in Trek today. And that's kind of awesome to see. And I love everybody's commitment, especially the actors in the first two seasons, to this material, because it wasn't always secure in the message it was trying to put out. And I got from these first two seasons, that message was always a positive thing and always trying to show humanity in a positive light. And maybe it was a rocky start to begin with, but the intentions were good.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
Cirroc's like, did you say intendant?
The intendant. No, but the heart was in the right place. And I was kind of blown away by how progressive some of these messages were for the time it was created. And Chaos on the Bridge really gave me an appreciation for those struggles and seeing what was going on in productions and on the sets and all of these big wigs who have kind of archaic ideas of how things are done and what messages should be told. Star Trek has always been pushing against those archaic mm-hmm. ideas, even if they stumble through bringing that to the audience. So I have a very good appreciation for what these first two seasons did, because they muscled through. You all muscled through it.
Totally. So we're going to take a quick break, everybody, if you can believe that. But we have so many more awesome questions and some good answers, probably. Be right back on The Seventh Rule.